I'm John Lake, and this is my wife, Meg Anderson, and we'll be interviewing you today. And what we need is a rundown on your name, date of birth, where you were born, how and why you came to Highlands Ranch, what you've done in your life, and principal activities and interests. So just kind of, first of all, name, date of birth, all of that basic stuff.
Okay. I'm Lawrence Phipps III, and I was born October 28th, 1933, at St. Luke's Hospital in Denver. And then in 1937, when I was four, my father purchased Highlands Ranch. And I got to see it for the first time, and I remember my first view there.
Oh, really?
And what most impressed me was the white room, as we called it. Which is now everybody calls a solarium.
Yes.
And I can remember that as a four-year-old kid.
Oh, boy.
So that's who I am.
That's an impressive room.
And what has been your occupation? What occupations have you had?
After I got out of college, I was in the Army Intelligence for 3 years. And then I came to Denver and got a job with the Denver Equipment Company in sales, and I sold mining equipment. And then after a year, I decided to go into business by myself and ended up doing some real estate deals. I went to a friend who was in real estate, very successful in Denver, told him I wanted to get my feet wet in real estate. He says, "Lawrence, don't drown." And I damn near did. So that's my story. I helped my father buy this ranch here in Elbert County after the flood of 1965, when the Army Corps of Engineers had slated a couple thousand acres of my father's ranch for condemnation. And in condemnation, it's not a willing sale. You know, you have to sell. And so if you reinvest in real estate, that sale process is not taxable. And so my father bought this ranch in the expectation of getting free proceeds from Chapter 10. And he did, finally, 10 years later. And the tax people had to make a special exception. As it turns out, large condemnations like this by the government customarily take 10 years. And we didn't either. Our lawyers didn't know this.
Oh.
And so, after he died, Gerald Phipps and I were named as executors of his estate. And I administered Highlands Ranch, and this ranch, and after a while, decided with some partners to buy this ranch, and because there was a conflict of interest between me as a buyer and me being the executor, it had to be a pretty open sale, and so the judge had us expose this on the open market for 1 year at the price I'd offer, when nobody came up to that number, and I got it.
So it was, that's this ranch, the quarter bill, quarter circle bill ranch.
Right.
Yeah. Okay.
And by that time, I'd severed my relationship with Mission Viejo, and they decided to do the cattle operation on their own.
Now, what was the relation to Gerald Phipps? You were both exemplars.
He's my uncle. And he was a contractor, and when I started dealing with him in business, I'd always heard people say very good things about him business-wise. And he was that way. He was in a spectacular fashion, honest and forthright in his dealings. And I think that was the secret to his being a general contractor. He gave the impression, which he carried out, of this is the contractor you wanted, whatever the price.
Yeah.
And that's a compliment to him.
Yeah, well, that's how he was to deal with. Mm-hmm. And we had many discussions, but no major arguments.
Uh-huh.
And we administered the estate for some 8 years before we were discharged and the estate was settled.
You did have the Highlands Ranch, and then, but that had some property up on County Line, too.
There was one section of land in Arapahoe County, which was midway between University and Colorado Boulevard. And, of course, it was quite valuable from a development standpoint. And my father was running short of cash 6 months before he died and needed money very badly. And so I made a deal, or I talked him into making a deal, to sell 80 acres to a developer, Trammell Crow, with options on more 80s. And so that was the land. That was already under contract, essentially, by the time he died. And by that time, because of those sales, he didn't have a cash crunch.
Yeah. Good for you.
Well, in turn, Trammell Crow and his partners were real good business people.
They are, yeah. Oh. Well, you have quite a family tree.
Yes.
Going back to the senator, Lawrence Sr. How does all that, the story of that?
Well, he had... The senator had three sons and three daughters. I didn't know the daughters very well. And I knew the sons, my father, and Alan Phipps was the lawyer, and Gerald Phipps was the contractor. And I just, you know, as a kid, they were older, and I had social dealings with them. I never had a clue of what Gerald was like to deal with in business. So, that's the family.
And you didn't know the sisters?
Well, I knew them, but my father had a full sister who had married a lawyer in Philadelphia. And she was a devout There's a cult in Philadelphia, a religious cult. I can't think of it offhand.
What was her name?
I don't remember.
That's allowed.
And we understand that very well.
Yeah.
And then the other two daughters were married to real estate people in Denver. One was named, had the last name of Garrett, and the other one had the last name of Bromfield. And I saw them socially, but really didn't have, I had more interaction with their children and grandchildren than I did with them.
And then your father, he had, what, how many wives? Two?
Three.
Three.
He had three wives, three daughters by the first wife, and three children by the second wife, me, my sister, Richmond, and my brother, Henry. And then no children by the third wife, Mamie.
What were the wives' names? Do you remember any of those? Well, your mother's. Close.
My mother did not enjoy her first name. And by the time we were eight or four, it was very dangerous to ever even think of her name. And she's been dead now for more than 50 years, and I'm still terrified and refuse to say what her name was.
What did you call her?
Mom.
Oh, I see. That makes sense.
And the third wife was named Lainey.
Oh. How do you spell that?
Well, it was Elaine was her full name, but everybody called her Lainey, L-A-I-N-E-Y.
Oh, yeah. Okay. Huh. And then you had a wife or two.
Yeah, I've had two wives so far.
Yes.
And Suzanne was the first. And but that marriage was she divorced me after 3 years of marriage. And then the second wife was named Marie.
And that's 20 years. We happen to know that. Yeah. And then you had how many sons?
Just one.
Yes. Lorenzo?
Yes.
And then daughters?
None.
It's kind of outside my area of expertise. Our next subject is Frank Kistler.
Okay.
Did you remember him at all?
No, I don't know if I ever met him.
Yeah, because you were four.
I was four when my father bought the place, and by that time the place was already in the bank's hands.
Ah. So your dad went and negotiated with the bank.
I don't know who he negotiated with.
Yeah.
At any rate, he took over Kistler's loan at the bank.
Yes.
And that's the loan he was never able to pay off.
Uh-huh.
And finally, after his death, Gerald and I paid it off.
Mm-hmm.
And that was the Frank Kistler loan.
I'll be darned. Whatever happened to Frank Kistler?
Well, part of the deal was that he got something. And so what he got was a highly mortgaged Colorado hotel in Glenwood Springs with a hot spa, with a hot springs.
Yes.
And he moved there and managed that.
Oh my gosh. I did not know that.
Oh, there's a question here about the Phipps Mansion in Denver.
Well, that's my grandfather's house. And that was built in 1934. The year after I was born.
Uh-huh.
And that's the Bill Carroll Mansion.
Yes.
Right.
Right. We've enjoyed that many times.
Yeah, I've been there for parties. It's wonderful for parties.
It is. Yeah. Even the tennis pavilion. We've had parties there.
Yeah. Yeah, me too. I've had relatives get married there.
Yeah.
And
great spot.
Yeah.
And then, but that sold. DU had it for a while.
Right.
And then they sold it.
And DU used it as a conference center.
Yes.
But the cost of its upkeep far exceeded its value as a conference center. And as its costs rose with inflation and deteriorating 1930s plumbing and heating and no air conditioning. And,
yes. So when did you actually move to Highlands Ranch Mansion?
Which time?
The first time.
1937. Yeah. 2 weeks after us kids toured it with our parents.
Wow.
Oh my gosh. At that time, you know, it was under contract to my father.
Yes.
But it hadn't closed.
Uh-huh.
As soon as it closed, we'd been living in a house on Ray Street, and that got sold, and we moved to the ranch.
Now, which room were you in? Do you remember? Which was your bedroom?
Yeah. Initially, it was the second one up. As time went on, I ended up in every bedroom except the one at the end with the fancy bathroom.
Right. Yes, yes, yes.
But I've slept in every other bedroom.
They just opened up a bedroom off the servant. It was in the servant's quarters, I guess. And Highlands Ranch has just opened that up for tours and
uh-huh.
things like that.
They've got it furnished in older furniture and things. We saw it the other day, but we don't know much about it yet. So.
Yeah. So where the servants' quarters were, that was the original house.
Mm-hmm. Yes. The Rotherwood house.
Yeah.
Then you lived there for a few years before you moved to Wyoming?
Yeah, I lived there for 3 years until 1940. And that's when my mother and father got divorced. And under Colorado divorce laws then, there had to be a 2-year separation before a divorce was granted. And so my mother went originally to Arizona, then to California, then to Wyoming, and then the divorce became final. Mm-hmm.
Okay. Then you lived in Wyoming for
yeah.
several years.
Oh, yeah. That's where I went to school. We started out living on Prairie Dog Creek in east of Sheridan. And my mother and stepfather traded that place for one south of Buffalo. So that's where I went to grades 7 and 8, and then on to high school.
Sheridan has quite a history, doesn't it, that town?
Yeah. Yeah, Bighorn has the big history. See, it was the capital of Wyoming at one time. And it's never had a population of more than 250 people. I think that's its current population. And that was its population in 1890. And it, but that's where the big landowners were. And that's where they still are. And, it was, when I was growing up in Buffalo, Wyoming, it was a very sophisticated place. In the wintertime, there'd be a couple parties every week, and every party you had to wear a tuxedo to.
Wow.
And you'd hear three or four languages being spoken. These are small parties of 30 people. And so there were some large parties of up to 100 people. But when you got an informal invitation, you hauled out your tuxedo.
Wow. Amazing in Wyoming.
Well, that had quite a, apparently settled by a lot of English people.
Well, they're English and Italian people.
Ah.
There was a salesman in Wyoming in those days, in the 1890s and 80s, named Morton Fruin. And Morton Fruin shared the attentions of his mistress with King Edward VIII.
Oh my gosh.
And they shared the same mistress, who was Lily Langtry.
Oh, yes.
The most beautiful woman in the world.
I recall that.
And he sold all these ranches to these investors, and they'd send their second and third sons there.
Yes.
And because of English primogeniture rules. And he also sold a lot of mining properties in Australia. And these people all lost their cattle in the blizzard of 1888. And the same year, this mining company in Australia went into receivership. Its name was Broken Hill Proprietary, which is the modern BHP.
Yeah.
And Bighorn, in turn, also rose from the ashes. But Morton Fruin, thereafter in London, was always called Norton Ruin. Or Mortal Ruin.
We digressed a little bit into different territory, but that's fascinating to me how that settled up there.
Oh, yeah.
Very closed society, actually.
Yeah.
Did you run cattle up there?
Yeah. Yeah, we had cattle and sheep. Yeah, it makes you wonder what Lily Langtry thought of those two idiots.
Yes. Yes. Oh, back to the mansion.
Sure.
You remember that.
We took off into space there, unfortunately. I guess if we're doing the interview, we could do that.
Yes.
What was the mansion when you lived there? What was it like? Well, what, you came back from Wyoming after the war.
It hadn't changed. My father made no changes in the mansion.
Ah.
He took it over from Kistler, and and moved in some of his own furniture, inherited a lot of Kistler's furniture, the big white table in the white room, for example, and the clock on the wall.
Yes. Oh, yes.
And when Kistler sold it, that clock was accepted from the contract.
Oh.
Kistler was supposed to come and get it. And then our lawyers, when they saw it in my father's estate, they said that clock is personal property.
Oh, yeah.
And it has to be sold separate from the land. And I had to take them back and show them how there's a fireplace behind that clock and a 4-foot thick wall.
Yeah, yes.
And I guess, you know, with explosives and a backhoe, you can get that clock. But
well, yeah.
But otherwise, it'd sure be hard.
Yes.
And
yeah.
It was hard to explain to those lawyers that was not personal property.
Yes. Well, we love having it. They have it running again.
Good.
Yeah.
That's first news. My father got it running once.
Really?
In my lifetime. That
uh-huh. It is running. It gongs on every 15 minutes and on the hour.
Oh, I know the gong. Yeah.
Yes, it's wonderful.
Yeah, he got it running for a couple of years, and then it fell silent.
So when did you move back there? What year?
Well, when I got out of the Army, I moved back there temporarily. And then I got the job with the mining supply company, and I got an apartment in Denver instead. So I was only back at the ranch for a couple of weeks.
Oh, okay.
And maybe a month. Hell.
Then when did you actually move back into it then?
I never did move back in.
Ah, okay.
Say, my father was there until he died. That's where he died. And I was still running the ranch. There was no change in ranch operations after he died.
When did you take over the ranch?
Oh, I took over. I became his attorney, in fact, maybe 8 or 10 years before his death. But I didn't exercise those powers until he got weaker and he had me go to some auctions and do some land deals. But I wasn't too active until about 9 months before he died. He had a heart attack. And then I took over all operations. Mm-hmm. And that was the heart attack and the cash crunch.
Yeah.
All at once. And
What were other fond memories of the mansion for you?
I never had any fond memories of the mansion.
I'm trying, Lawrence. I'm trying.
I can dearly remember 1 year I got there. Usually, you know, my parents were divorced, but we'd spend as kids 2 or 3 weeks every summer at the ranch.
Mm-hmm.
And all we wanted to do was go to Elitch's or get out and get on a horse.
Yes.
And we left a ranch in Wyoming, and so we were used to, you know, I was used to more welding something up in the shop rather than sitting down to tea with my stepmother.
Yes.
And but I do remember one year I was down for stock show, and I had a free day, and I went to the mansion and some pipes frozen upstairs, and there's these beautiful stalactites, icicles, hanging down. Some of them were 3 feet in diameter,
ooh.
And touch the floor, that concrete floor of the porch that goes around on the ground level. And it was quite a, you know, artistic sight.
For inside the mansion. Did you call it the mansion?
No.
What did you call it? The ranch?
The main house.
Main
house. Or the big house.
Uh-huh.
The big house, we called it. Everybody on the ranch called it the big house.
I see. But your dad ran cattle there.
Yeah.
He had a...
And it was, you know, a little fancier than we were doing it in Wyoming. Okay. He had not only his cow-calf herd, like we did, that produced calves every year, but he bred his own bulls, and he had a registered cow herd with every cow had papers and horn weights, and they were Herefords, and so they'd take the horns that were like this, and they'd bend them around, so they were all beautiful for the stock show.
Oh, my gosh.
And they wouldn't put out your eye when you tried to hurt them.
But you were involved, I remember, with Tweet, because you had to work out the deal with her about maintaining the common fence.
Right. Bud Morgan took me over there in 1955 when I got out of the Army.
But who was he?
He was one of the foremen at the ranch.
Uh-huh.
He ran the cattle operation.
Uh-huh.
He was Marion Morgan's husband.
Oh.
And that's how I met Tweet. And we discussed building the fence and sharing expenses. And it was a pleasant conversation. And she shared all the expenses. We had to do the work.
Yeah.
She it just was getting organized and So that's how that went.
But your dad had the Arapaho hunt there for many years.
Yes.
Right from the beginning?
Yes, he did that with Kistler's permission. Kistler owned the ranch.
Yeah.
The hunt was located at the south side of the ranch. He hired George Beeman 2 years before he bought the ranch.
Oh. One of the memories that some of the others have about that land, about being at the big house, was that on the 4th of July, there was a big fireworks display there. You remember that?
Oh, yeah.
Part of your history?
Yeah, I remember being to several of those events. And you know, there were a couple of very dry years that it was canceled because of the fire danger.
Sure.
And there was always, my father was concerned about those fireworks getting out of hand.
Yeah. Good reason.
And those juniper trees on the entrance of the mansion are flammable.
Yeah.
So were the pine trees.
Oh, yeah.
It was
say nothing of the grasslands. Yeah. Yeah. What other celebrations did you have there? Anything else that steps out in your mind? I know that you didn't have a great time there, but...
You know, there were a couple of weddings in the family.
Oh.
And then... there were several hunt breakfasts there.
Oh, yes.
Well, after the hunt, we'd all go there, and they were big catered events, and those were fun.
Um,
Anything, stories about the barns around the big house at all? Or?
Well, I spent a lot of time in those barns.
Yes.
Some had been built at the turn of the century. Others had been built before Phillips got there. And then others had been built, the big white barn, we called it, the milking barn, had been built by Kistler when he wanted to turn the place into a milk farm. And his answer to paying off his loans was to build that barn and get in dairy cows. But when he did, he found out that the Mountain Empire Dairyman's Association in those days was a closed club.
Uh-huh.
And he had nowhere to go with his milk. And that's what got Kistler. That's why he had to sell.
Depression came right in that area of time, didn't it?
No, well, yes. When Kistler was there, yeah. Mm-hmm. Sure was.
Yeah. Yeah.
Didn't help.
No, sure it didn't. Do you remember the bowling alley?
Oh, yeah, we used to play there.
What about the bowling alley?
Well, we'd have to talk one of us siblings into setting pins.
Oh, well, yes.
And then the others would, and occasionally we'd get a visitor who wanted to learn how to set pins. And,
oh, gee, we'll show you.
Yeah, we made sure that they were well practiced by the time.
Love it.
We played there a lot.
Yeah. I remember Joan saying that she remembers ice skating on that veranda out there.
Yeah.
Freezing it over in the wintertime, ice skating on it.
Yeah.
What do you remember about the Chum Howe house?
Well, my sister Mimi built it. Her husband was in the lumber business. Mm-hmm. And so they used nothing but the finest lumber. And inside, though, is a bit gothic.
Is it?
It's dark. They have small, narrow little windows. But it was certainly beautifully built, and that's where all the young family grew up, and some of them were almost my age.
Yes.
Oh, yes.
So we saw a lot of
wonderful. Great guy. Did you bring the map that you have that you wanted? We don't need to do that on camera, do we? We'll get you to mark boundaries on the map or something. They want that.
Okay.
The windmills and the wells. You had quite a few wells on the ranch, I imagine.
Right. And working with windmill crews is how I learned about windmills.
Yes.
And when a windmill fails, you have two options. You can do what your instinct tells you to do, and that way, time will give you a chance to see whether the will learns anything. Or you learn anything.
Okay.
So your instincts aren't always true.
So, the other way is to do it the way old windmill people do it. And pull it, change the leathers, stick it back in the ground, examine the outer casing, examine the inner casing, and replace with climb up on the tower. And,
dangerous stuff.
Yeah, dangerous stuff.
Didn't you say the rattlesnakes like the windmills?
Oh, that was the rocks around the rock face of it.
A rock-enclosed windmill, the big one,
yeah,
up on the hill. Mm-hmm. Was always full of rattlesnakes. Mm-hmm. And then there was a pump house further southeast where the big Douglas aquifer well is, Arapaho aquifer well. And that's the one that supplied the ranch then, and I think it's still in functioning. It had a little house that was always full of rattlesnakes. And it would often have electrical disturbances.
Oh, yeah.
Spiders would build webs and trip circuit breakers. And there you go in, you know, and that's when it's bright, middle of summer, and you walk into a dark little shack with no windows.
You can't see.
And everything rattling at you.
go in shooting.
Oh, boy. That was a...
Did you ever get bit by a snake?
No.
Yeah. Good.
My mother liked snakes and taught me to be friends with snakes. And especially bull snakes.
Yes.
And when I was riding, you know, as a kid, I'd pick them up and shove their head up my sleeve and let them wiggle. And they go, come out here. And then I show them down here. The long ones, you know, I just ride home.
Oh, my God.
Tail sticking out and the head out.
Crazy.
And then I had one snake, a pet snake, and he didn't like anybody else in the family. He'd hiss and try to bite him and snap at him. And,
a bull snake.
Yeah, but I'd wrap him around my legs when I go to sleep at night, you know. And in the morning, he'd still be there. But I remember one day I was sick, and I had the flu. Some neighbor lady came, and my mother explained how I was sick. She had to come look, and as soon as she did, I took covers off and heard her go screaming out of there.
Oh, dear.
Yeah, that was fun.
Oh, yes.
Rattlesnakes, when I started managing the ranch, there was a time when I was wearing slippers like Mark is. When I'd get in the car, I'd slip them off and drive barefoot. And I had to go out and check a well once in this car. Hot, hot day, 100 degrees, and wind blowing. And I came to a gate, opened the door of the car, and jumped out barefooted, stepped on a snake. On a rattlesnake.
Really?
Yeah. And you know, we both knew how to fly. That rattlesnake went shooting off that way, and I went shooting off this way. And the funny thing is, I had a gun sitting on the pistol on the front seat of the car, and I grabbed that gun and never could find the snake. He'd flown away. Yep. That's how you learn about yourself.
Yeah. Sure do. life has lots of lessons for us. What about homesteads around? There's something called the Failing Douglas Festival.
South of the Kells.
Yes.
There's, it's a 1,400-acre property. It's located for a quarter mile east of Highway 85. And so the only entry is through somebody else's property. And it stretched up and around parts, two sides of Daniels Park.
Wow.
And it went all the way to the Daniels Park Road on the north side. And, of course, this was the most scenic property in the ranch. My father bought it shortly after the Second World War.
Ah.
And he was proud to add that.
Yes.
And that's what gave us the boundary between.
Yes. Right, yes. What about the Griggs? Names.
It doesn't ring any bell either.
Yeah.
Griggs Homestead. Yes. The Griggs Homestead is toward the northeast portion of the ranch property right now. The closest boundary is just to the west of Monarch Boulevard. Going up the hill.
Which boulevard?
The hill.
Monarch.
Monarch. It's just to the west of Monarch.
By Wildcat.
South of the high school there and the junior high.
Yeah.
And Rock Canyon.
Right.
And Briggs, as we understand it, had a homestead there, but he was also a way station on the road up to Daniels Park.
Yeah, well, I didn't know him, and we gave that property a different name.
It'll bubble up.
What?
That name will bubble up.
Probably.
Was that what you referred to as the East Ranch, or was the East more of the Cheese Ranch?
The East Ranch was the Cheese Ranch.
Yeah, and this is to the south of that.
Exactly.
Yeah.
On MacArthur Ranch Road.
Just south of MacArthur Ranch Road. Yes.
Yeah. Yeah, that had already been subdivided, and there were little, 35-acre ranchettes in there.
Well, the Flying Bee, that was down...
That's Bowen's property.
Yeah.
And my father owned that property, and he needed money, and he sold it to a member of the Hunt who was going to build a house there. But then the war came along, and it didn't work, and Bowen took it over.
But how much land was with that?
There originally was a quarter section, 160 acres. Here again, they were very scenic.
Yeah.
There were cottonwoods and the Highland Canal running through it. And Bowen built its runway.
Yeah.
And,
Any other homesteads around there?
Well, there was one along the County Line Road, midway between Bowen and that my father bought, and it was a separate house, garage and barn and 10 acres. And I've forgotten what we called that. We rented it out. And
the Chatfield land, you had That was your hay field down there.
And it was our hay ground because here in Colorado, if you don't have irrigation or sub-irrigation, you're not much of a hay producer.
Yeah. Was it sub-irrigated?
No.
No, okay.
But it had water rights.
Yeah.
And there had been, at the turn of the century, three ditches there. And I've forgotten their names. But my father went to water court and converted that into adjudicated well rights.
Yeah.
And,
big thing, the water rights.
Yeah. Yeah, I ended up doing a lot of water stuff for my father.
Yes.
And
what were your issues when the flood of 65 on the ranch? Did that affect you all?
Well, sure, I remember. It came down. And it took out the Highline Canal flume. So it was 2 years before that canal worked again.
2 years.
Maybe three. And it took out, a lot of blood, bridges going over to the Martin plant. And washed out a lot of homes down there next to it.
Did you lose cattle in that?
Sometimes in the wintertime. Mm-hmm. We passed through the alfalfa. Yeah. Yeah, we had cattle there.
But did you lose any in the flood?
No.
No. What do we know about the Plum Creek School?
Nothing?
Yeah. That's what we know. That's what I know. And where did the name Blakeland come from?
No idea.
Because that was before Joe Blake was around.
Oh, yeah, of course.
Yeah.
It was a very colorful guy named Ray Nelson had the coffee shop down in Blakeland. And we all called it Blakeland and have been called that since the Depression. And it was an old name back by 1951.
So there was a coffee shop. And then what's the name of that where all the gambling was? Wolfhurst. Yeah.
No.
Did you get into that?
No. Oh.
Hang around?
No. Blakeland, as I said, it had a very colorful person named Roy Nelson that ran it.
Uh-huh.
And then he had an even more colorful daughter.
Oh.
That was a couple years younger than me. But nothing ever developed.
But you explored.
Yeah. She went on to become a country and western singer and was supported by the International Harvester Company. And her name was Transtar Rose.
That's a colorful name.
Good old Rose. I know we covered this before in the other interview, but the condemnation and of that property, and you covered it a little bit earlier. Anything to add about the Chatfield and all of that dam and all that? Because I know that was a big thing for you.
And it was a big thing for Denver. And the reality is, Denver really shouldn't want to see another flood of 1965. And as the Corps of Engineers said, that occurs only once every 100 years. But, which 100 years?
Yes. And that's one out of 100. Yeah.
Yeah. So, but we were sad to lose that land.
Yes.
And we were really distressed, say, we had our, you know, in a condemnation where you disagree on the initial offer, which our appraiser, Waddy Bowes, who was very conservative, considered to be 10% of the actual value of the land. And that's not a realistic offer. And that's what we told the court. And so they hired an elderly appraiser with emphysema. And it took the case, you know, 2.5 years to reach federal court. And by that time, he was dead. And so they told federal court they needed time to hire another appraiser and do another appraisal, because their appraiser was dead. The court had no other choice but to grant them that time. And so we went from, you know, 2 years of discovery and appointed point court date, another 2 years further. And then for the second appraiser, that was another 2 years. And then even when the number came down judicially, we still couldn't collect. And in those days, apparently, it took an act of Congress. It was an amount over $1 million. Which today is peanuts, but then was not.
Yeah.
And they said, well, we can't make any, Treasury can't make any payments of more than $1 million without an act of Congress.
Yes.
And so my father went back with his lawyers and had to get the Colorado delegation, congressional delegation, the senators and congressmen. And both parties supported him and got the payments made. But it was not a pleasant thing. And only then could we make the appeal to the IRS about the taxes.
Right.
And it was difficult.
Yeah. What was your brand for the cattle out on the on Highlands Ranch?
It was a quarter circle with a bell underneath.
Oh, the same brand.
That is the brand.
Yeah. Oh, okay.
That's the only brand we used.
Oh, okay. Okay. How did you ever come up with that?
Well, that was my father's brand.
Yes.
And I talked to him about it once. I said, you know, you were one of the founding directors of Mountain States Tell, and their logo is a circle with a bell in it, because it was one of the bell companies. He said, no connection. He said, there was nothing to do with that. I just independently came up with that long before. So
there's an untold story there somewhere.
Yeah. Yeah, well, now you know what I know.
Well, we're perking right along here. You're doing great. I think we covered all the Marvin Davis and the sale of the property and everything previously. We don't need to. And we did the filming of Centennial. There wasn't a lot. Where did the Longhorns come from in Centennial, in the film?
I have no idea. And they were not filmed. Those segments were not filmed at Highlands Ranch.
Right, yeah.
And there is a guy, and I can't remember his name, in El Paso County that has a big herd of longhorns.
Ah.
And so I would suspect that's where the...
rented those.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You got to... Well, that's probably his... You know, the problem with longhorns is they eat a lot of grass and they don't make much beef.
Yeah.
And they were the only beef to start with back in the early days because they were the only things that could walk from South Texas to railheads in Kansas.
Yeah. Yeah.
But those days passed.
Yeah. Do you have any involvement with the Littleton area, the people of Littleton at all?
Not really.
Not really. Because we had some friends, Donna, were Herford's folks. He's a Smith now. We covered Cherokee. Trying to make sure I get all these things covered while we have the chance.
Yeah.
Any other recollections you want to share of these things? The importance of your growing up here in this area?
Well, I only partially grew up in that area.
Right.
And I partially grew up in Northern Wyoming.
Yes.
And for some reason, the stories of Lily Langtry were much more exciting than somebody in Littleton.
I can understand that.
Now, we'd come down every year to Stock Show, and that was the big thing. And we'd see my father then, spend a few days with him. And but we never really had time, you know, to get acquainted with the community.
How about other people that stayed with your father? He had all those bedrooms up there, and it was a great place for visitors to stay over. It was set up real well.
Yeah, it was. I had a guy call me up the other day saying he was reading the obituaries in the New York Times, and my name was prominently mentioned.
The obit?
Yeah.
Really?
And some oil exploration guy that became very famous had died. And the one thing he talked about in his latter years was when he was a kid going off to college, he wanted to play polo. Lawrence Phipps Jr. had encouraged him to play polo and let him ride a lot of his horses, and he stayed in the big house in one of the bedrooms. I remember it. He stayed in that first bedroom. And for about 6 months, then he went off to Middlebury, I think, for college. And my father said, well, here, take three polo ponies with you. Well, this was in the early 1950s, and the railroads no longer handled horses so well, and the airlines hadn't learned to do it yet. And he ended up in Middlebury with three horses, and they had no stabling, and, you know, it's in northern New England with severe winters and no equestrian programs whatsoever. Here this poor guy was with three finished polo ponies waiting for a game to occur.
Oh, my God.
And
okay didn't meet the needs.
So he made it through Middlebury and graduated. Then he went back to Oklahoma, where he was from. And he still had his horses with him. And he started playing polo. And he played polo then till he was in his 70s. And he kept on telling him that's what got him started in polo.
Yes.
And so I asked Marvin Beeman, I said, do you remember your father giving away three of the best polo ponies? And this was when Marvin was playing polo at CSU. And I was a freshman at Princeton. And Marvin had no memory whatsoever.
But how did your name get attached to the obituary?
Oh, well, it's just Lawrence Phipps.
But just as a friend of his?
No, as somebody who gave him, Lawrence Phipps gave him three horses as a freshman in Middlebury.
And we didn't cover the polo playing around here. Did they play regularly on the ranch at all? Or?
Oh, yeah.
You had polo fields there?
Well, we had one polo field there.
Yeah.
Near the police training, at the entrance to the police training area. And there was a well there to irrigate it. And polo fields, to be bearable, have to be irrigated. And my father developed it largely for me, I think. And at first it was a dirt field. And we played in the dirt. And then one day he planted it, and we didn't play at all. And then the next year it was ready. And so this is where the Plum Creek Polo Club had most of its games.
I am.
And there were other fields around. On Road 105, Dr. Carlisle Pollock had an indoor arena we played. And then further south, 105, on the Dakin Mountain Road.
Oh, yeah.
Bill Sinclair built the first polo field south of his home, and then near Turtle Rock on the Dakin Mountain Road. And we played there, but still the principal location was Highlands Ranch. And the problem with polo is that it's always accompanied by intense politics. And the hunt is too, but the hunt, when my father was alive, he was the principal sponsor, and we had dues, but they were more of a token contribution than a realistic cost of the expense. And of course, when he died, that had to change.
Yes.
And Don O'Connor, Art Cook, and several others helped make that change come. And now it's a democratically operated hunt with politics.
Yes, we're aware of the politics.
Yes.
Did you play polo in Princeton?
Well, not really. I played a little indoor polo, but there weren't any horses in Princeton. There was a wooden horse in a cage where we could sit there and practice. And I did that a couple of times. And I happened to know the director of athletics at Princeton. And he said, if Yale and Cornell, who both had active polo programs with horses, if they had invited us and let us play on their horses, he'd give us jerseys. Huh. And boy, he, we'd leave Friday night for a Saturday game, and he wouldn't give us the jerseys until 6 o'clock Friday night. And he wanted those jerseys back by 8 o'clock Monday morning. And we'd get on, Yale would give us whatever horses they chose to give us. And we hadn't been riding or practicing and riding together. They'd whoop us. And, yeah. And a month later, we'd do the same with Cornell. They'd whoop us. So I sort of played polo at Princeton. But polo, you really should be riding several times a week just to be in shape to do it.
Yeah. Are there any other memories that you've got that you share? Do you feel that you want to tell us about? Or is that pretty much covered?
Well, you had an active life in Denver in your apartment for many years.
Yeah, in my house. Then I had a house.
Then you had a house?
Yeah.
Where was that then?
That was 13th and Columbine in Capitol Hill.
Oh.
And that's where I started entertaining once a week.
Oh.
Oh my gosh, Lawrence.
And.
Wild. We had joy.
Yeah, much like the things we do today. Except I wasn't married.
Yes.
That didn't make a difference.
Were there any outstanding memories that you have of that time?
Television? I had trouble balancing the parties. I like to have a disparate crowd, in case you hadn't noticed.
Yeah.
And, but I couldn't help it. One week I had nothing but lawyers. And the next week there'd be nothing but doctors. And then the next week there'd be nothing but people from Iran or Iraq. And I had this associate in Baghdad, and he played oud. And he was a great musician. And he used to come every week, and he had a friend that was a drummer who was Baker in Denver. Another friend that had been in the first violin section of the Cleveland Orchestra and went through a messy divorce and came to Denver and went through medical school. He was a violinist and a great musician. And he was a devout Jew. The drummer was a devout Christian. And he was a devout Muslim. And they loved playing together. And belly dancers would vie for each other, with each other for their time. They'd use my bedroom to change in, and then they'd come down and they didn't care whether it was doctors, lawyers, or Iranians there. That's what they did every week.
Yeah.
It was fun. And often we'd have a lot of flamenco people there.
Yeah. Oh, and then Rene.
Yeah.
Rene.
And then we had some country and western folk musician friends too. And they'd come a lot to those parties. But one memorable occasion was one of those Tuesday nights, suddenly, was during the Iranian-Iraq War, when And Ron was sending in these battalions of young fanatics in charge with just a spear against the machine guns.
Wow.
And Saddam was saying that these tanks and machine guns and poison gas. And it was a very bitterly fought war. So one night, suddenly, the whole group was split between the Iranians and the Iraqis that were there.
Oh, yeah.
And my friend Bill Berger went to them. They were arguing with each other. And he says, God, you guys ought to calm down and be glad that you're here in Denver eating and drinking. And,
yeah.
And they says, you know, you're right.
Yeah.
And what a concept.
Yeah.
So,
we should check with you on the death of your father, which we talked about briefly. He did die in the mansion.
Yeah.
And then how was Marvin Davis, the one that ended up with the mansion? Do you remember how that all came about?
Yeah. I ended up having lunch with some home builders. And they said, well, it's a state deal. We want to buy a section of land. And I said, well, you can't do that. But the whole thing is for sale. And I said, but, you know, most home builders, they buy with a little down and yearly payments as they make money. And you can't do that in an estate. It has to be all cash. And so you got to bring in the heavyweights. They're able to do it. So they brought in Marvin Davis.
Oh, okay.
That's his connection. And he took to it personally. He, came out with his lawyers one day, wanted to see me and have a tour, look at the cows. He said, well, how do you look at the cows? And I said, oh, I just get out of the car and call them, and they'll come. And so all the cows came and clustered around. I said, so you can see them. And so then he turned to his lawyer and he said, oh, Jesus, I got an appointment in Denver. Honk your horn and let's get out through these cows. And I said, oh, don't do that, Marvin. You know, if you honk your horn, those cows will follow you all the way back to your office. And he says, you know, I just learned something.
Yes. So you got along well with him.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You didn't really know him before
that. Well, yeah. I did know him. He was a fixture on 17th Street in Denver. At noontime, he just loved what he called the schmooze.
Yeah.
You know, and he'd sit there, he'd make deals on the corner, right there at lunchtime. That was lunch for him. And,
with you?
No, I don't have any pictures of him. I've seen pictures of him in the Denver Post, you know, all three journals.
Well, I'm sure there's lots of them on his website.
Yeah.
Controversy with neighbors on sale of the mansion? Did you have any problems with neighbors? You don't have it?
Oh, you know, we were under pressure to make payments to the IRS that far exceeded any money I got from that section in Arapahoe County. Mm-hmm. And it actually were, That was huge payments. I don't know what it was. Millions of dollars.
Yeah.
And I was sure glad to suddenly get liquid and get that thing done. We signed the deeds and they gave the checks to our lawyers, accountants. It was in the Mile High building, and our lawyer put the checks in his pocket. He said, "Now, do you want an armed guard going back to your bank?" He said, "No, I don't need an armed guard. And you want an armored car?" And he said, "No, I'll just walk down there." Probably with Gerald and Lawrence Phipps.
Oh my God.
And we'll deposit the checks and then we'll have lunch.
Yeah.
And it was a celebratory lunch, and it was just a fast sandwich, and that was it.
Oh my gosh.
But it was a celebratory.
Well, sure. Yeah.
And,
the bankers were glad to see you.
Oh boy.
Well, of course, we really thank you for your time. And
well, this has been fun.
Well, we've loved it. My goodness. Just wonderful. Thank you.
Yes.
I was going to bring up your speaking Russian, but I don't think that has anything to do with Highlands Ranch.
No. No, it doesn't help. Yeah.